Hi guys. So let's continue with the next topic, that is your councils and your dispute resolution mechanisms or your dispute resolution commissions. So in your dispute resolution commissions, we have a council and a dispute redressal commission. They're two separate entities, okay, where one council will be more governed with the admin work, the admin related matters, whereas this is dispute redressal. That means there is some kind of a dispute between a consumer and the person providing the goods and services, and at the district, state and national level, you have both the council as well as the dispute resolution. So let's look at the councils first. The first one is the Central Consumer Protection Council, that is known as the National Council. Okay, the central government has the power to establish such a council. But when they are establishing such a council, they are saying that the council should be an advisory council. That means they must give advice on matters relating to consumer protection, and it must consist of the following members. One is the minister in charge of the Department of Consumer Affairs at the national level, and this person will be the chairperson of the council. And they're saying such other official, non-official members as is required for the purpose of that council. How many times shall they meet? There should be at least one meeting in a year, and the location will be determined as per time to time. Okay, and what is the objective of the Central Council? They have to give advice on promotion and protection of consumer rights. So whether it is at the stage of developing policy or rules or the laws itself needs to be amended, this the Central Consumer Council will give their opinion on it. Next we have the State Consumer Protection Councils. The State Consumer Protection Councils are also similar to your Central Councils, wherein the state government has the authority to establish them. And if they are establishing them, then this council will also be an advisory council. Minister in charge of consumer affairs at the state level, and such other official, non-official members, which they're saying not exceeding 10. So you'll have your chairperson plus 10 other members. These people should meet at least two meetings in a year in a place that they determine to be required for the purpose of meeting. Again, their object again is promotion as well as protection of consumer rights, but within where? Within the state itself. And then we come down to the District Consumer Protection Council. Okay, this District Consumer Protection Council again comes under the ambit of central government only. And this district council is basically both an advisory council, which will consist of your collector plus certain other members. Okay. How many times shall they meet? Two meetings in a year, again at a time within the district itself where they think fit and it is necessary to carry on their meetings. Again, they work on promotion and consumer rights within the district itself. So the only difference that you can see over here is at the national level, state level and within the district level itself. We're coming to the next authority known as the Central Consumer Protection Authority, where the central government is empowered under Section 10 to set up this authority, and they have certain objectives. One is to regulate all matters relating to violation of consumer rights. Then unfair trade practices, misleading advertisements. In a way, if you look at it, misleading advertisements comes under unfair trade practices also, and anything which is prejudicial to the interests of customers, the interests or the rights of customers. So this authority will be dealing directly with any violation of consumer rights. In short, who shall this authority consist of? Shall consist of a chief commissioner plus other commissioners who will be appointed by the central government. Okay. Right now, the headquarters of the central authority is in Delhi itself, and if they so require it, they can have regional offices as well as regional offices in other place located in India. Now, the law provides for what are the qualifications, what is the appointment method of appointment, how long they have to hold office for, their salaries, resignation, allowances, all of these things will be determined by the law itself. And then vacancy, when they look at it, they're saying that what if the chairperson decides to resign because of personal matters or some other personal reasons. In such a case, if there is no chairperson or there is no enough number of commissioners, then they're saying that no act or proceeding of the central authority will be invalidated simply because there was a defect in the constitution of the central authority. Means there must be a chief commissioner and such other commissioners. Now, if it so happens that the chief commissioner was not having the proper qualification, or he became disqualified at the time a certain decision was given, they're saying that it's okay, that's a procedural defect. That will not invalidate all of the decisions taken by this central authority. Similarly, they're saying no act or proceeding of the central authority will even be invalid in case of defect in the appointment of the chief commissioner or a commissioner. Okay, and any other irregularity in the procedure of the central authority which is not affecting the merits of the case. See, this provision is there purely to ensure that small procedural defects don't invalidate a much larger policy. Okay, because the central authority will be working towards the consumer protection. But if we sit and invalidate each one of their decisions simply on the ground that there's minor defects, something which is not even affecting the merits of the case, then that kind of invalidates the whole purpose of having that council itself. Okay. Now, next they're talking about appointment of officers, experts, professionals and certain other employees of the central authority. Now, the central authority is not expected to work with only the commissioners and such other commissioners. You're going to have certain junior officers or interns, or there'll be ranking of officers. Then obviously you'll need professionals, you'll need support staff, you'll need an infrastructure. You need all of these people who have some kind of knowledge of the regulations, who have special knowledge in areas of consumer rights, welfare, consumer policy, law, medicine, food safety, engineering, product safety, public affairs or administration. Because a consumer can come from every walk of life. It's not required that a consumer has to come only from one type of area. So being a part of the central authority means you need to have that much knowledge in all walks of life. Okay. What is the procedure to be of the central authority? Now, they're not going too much into the procedure. They're simply saying that the central authority by itself can lay down its own procedure and it can regulate itself. Now, what do you mean by regulating itself? It simply matters of administration. How to accept applications, how to deal with applications, what is the method of storage, what is the method of, saving documents, privacy, many things like this. All of these are certain procedures which should be determined by the central authority itself. Okay? Now you have the investigation wing of the central authority. Obviously, we are looking at central authority simply coming in because they are saying that, because they are saying that there is some kind of violation of consumer rights. So it obviously stands to state that the central authority should be allowed to investigate. Okay? So who has this power to investigate? They are saying that the central authority will have an investigation wing which is headed by the Director General. What is his objective? For the purpose of conducting inquiry, investigation under the law. Now, to support this Director General, you'll have certain other additional Director Generals to help him. And this can be a Joint Director, a Deputy Director, Assistant Director, people who have the qualifications to actually carry out the investigation. Now, these people, when they are carrying out investigations, they're saying that they should work under the directions of the Director General. And all of the powers, like anything that is required to be done by, say, the junior officers, junior officers, will be authorized by the Director General. Means that they will have the same power equal to the Director General when it comes to doing certain investigations. So that's all there is to this. Now we're coming to the power of the District Collector. Okay, so the District Collector is basically a person to whom they're saying you can make a complaint or a reference made to him by the central authority or the commissioner of a regional office to inquire into certain consumer rights violations or unfair trade practices, misleading advertisements, etc. So this District Collector is basically forwarded the central authority makes a reference to him, in which case he will inquire into and look into this matter. Okay. Now we'll come down to the powers and functions of the central authority. Now, time and again I have been telling you all, wherever you all see powers, functions, duties, make sure to mark it as very important, because that is the weightage part when they are asking for for exams. So let's look at the powers and functions of the central authority. One of the main power, we're looking at powers, is to protect, promote and enforce the rights of consumers. More importantly, they have to prevent violation of consumer rights under this act. They have to ensure that there are no unfair trade practices and that no person engages in unfair trade practices. Ensure that there is no false and misleading advertisements, and make sure that no person engages in the publication of false and misleading advertisements. Okay? Now, for the purpose, if they have this power to ensure that, okay, they can investigate, or they have to promote the rights of consumers, how do they go about doing it? So, for that purpose, they're saying that this central authority will have the power to inquire or cause an inquiry or an investigation into such unfair trade practices or consumer violation practices. Either they're saying suo moto or on a complaint basis. What do they mean by suo moto or complaint basis? Is that suo moto is on its own. In its own direction, it can take up a matter and it can start inquiring about it. This is a very special power given with regards to consumer this thing, because most other authorities have to depend on a complaint which is made by some central government, state government or such other authorities. But with the central authority, they're saying that it doesn't matter. The authority by itself can take up the matter and start investigating, or it can wait for a complaint received from the central government. Okay, then obviously it can file complaints before the district commission, state commission and the national commission under this act. That means they will do the investigation and then they will go and start filing the cases. Then in case there is any violation of consumer rights or unfair trade practices, they can intervene into any proceedings. Means they can put a pause to the proceedings and they can come and give their input and they can ensure that there is a protection of consumer rights. What do they mean by this point number C? Let's assume that before the district commission, there is a matter being heard between, say, a plaintiff and a defendant. Okay, but it so happens that this defendant has been violating many people's consumer rights. That means he's doing some activity which is completely violating consumer rights. So what the central authority can do is, they can approach these proceedings and they can actually give their input. See, intervene in any proceedings before district, state or national in respect of allegations of violation of consumer rights and UTP. So they can intervene over here as the central authority and they can put their input and say that, Your Honor, this defendant is not only violating this plaintiff's rights, but he is also in violation of multiple other consumer rights. Then we have, they have the power to review matters which is in any way preventing people from enjoying their consumer rights. They can even give recommendations for making policy. and even international best practices that people have to follow with regards to consumer rights. They can engage in research in that field. They can promote awareness and spread awareness, encourage NGOs and other institutions to work and cooperate for consumer protection agencies. Then they're saying over here, mandate the use of unique and universal goods identifiers to prevent unfair trade practices. What they mean by this is nothing other than when you are using certain goods, there are certain standards. Okay, so if you look at gold, they say 916 gold. So you know that 916 gold is to a very good extent pure. So anything other than 916 gold, you will not buy. So those are what we call as use of unique and universal good mandates, or in other words, standards that we can say this is followed uniformly everywhere, and these are the standards that we should try and maintain. Now, if a person is not maintaining these standards, then we can actually call that as a violation of consumer rights or even an unfair trade practice. Then, issue safety notice to alert consumers. They'll usually like send out messages, or they will take action against a lot of brands saying that these goods are likely to cause so and so danger to people. Then, advise ministry and departments and issue necessary guidelines to prevent unfair trade practices. Guys, I cannot stress on how important this topic is, especially from an exam point of view. We are looking at the powers and the manner in which they can execute their powers. They can take a recognition of matters on their own, or receive a complaint from central or state government. They can file complaints before the necessary commissions. They can intervene into matters that they feel is going to affect the larger consumer group in India. They can review all matters relating to existing consumer protection laws. They can actually recommend the implementation of certain policies which are in line with international standards. They can encourage research, spread awareness, encourage non-governmental organizations to work with each other, ensure the use of correct standards, issue notices to the consumers, advise ministries, and issue necessary guidelines which is required at the time to protect consumer interests. One more power of the central authority is the power to recall goods. If the central authority believes that certain goods are dangerous, hazardous, or unsafe, or if they feel that these goods are likely to cause danger to the public, then the central authority has to first do an investigation. So, as they're saying it, if the central authority is satisfied on the basis of that investigation that there is enough evidence to show that a consumer rights have been violated, then it can pass certain orders as a result of it. And what are these orders? Those orders are recalling the goods or withdrawal of services. So I don't know if you all remember, but sometime back Samsung phones suddenly started bursting. Okay, and Samsung did a good thing by recalling all of those goods. Now this I think happened even with regards to cars. I don't remember which car exactly, but it has happened before. So while recalling these, what ended up happening was people had to send their goods across in flights. Okay, and that turned out to be dangerous. So Samsung actually provided special boxes in which these people could come and keep their phones inside, and that box would ensure the proper or the safe arrival of those goods at the Samsung warehouse itself. This is one kind of an order the central authority can pass. They can ensure reimbursement of goods that have been purchased or even for services, and more importantly, discontinuation of the practices which are unfair. So they're saying that if this practice is unfair, you cannot allow it to continue at a later point. So these are the three kinds of orders that the central authority can pass. Now, the next one is section number 21, where they're talking about a special power to issue directions with regards to misleading or false advertisements. Okay, again, this has to be done as a result of investigation only. Okay, and they can pass the following orders. They're saying that if they can actually pass orders to discontinue this advertisement. So one is discontinue. The second one they can say is, they can say modify this agreement, or modify this advertisement. Or the third one is, they will allow this advertisement to exist, in which case they don't even have to intervene in this matter. Now, if they believe that it is necessary to impose penalties, okay, then what penalty can they impose because an advertisement has been given? They can impose a penalty of up to 10 lakh rupees. And if any further contravention keeps on happening, then it can extend up to an extent of 50 lakh rupees. Okay, so they can actually, the authority can say, okay, listen, you have to stop publishing this advertisement or even making an endorsement. Now, you all already know what an advertisement is. You all see advertisements every single day. But what do you exactly mean by an endorsement of a product? Have you seen how these, how a lot of celebrities, like suddenly you'll see something on their Instagram post or on their Twitter accounts, etc., where, you know, they're doing something and then suddenly they'll pull out a product, or they'll be wearing a particular shirt, or they will be using certain like hair products or some such thing. That is known as an endorsement. That means a celebrity is coming and saying, okay, see, I have such a big fan base and I am going to endorse your product. They'll talk to the company itself. So this can be in relation to a Samsung phone. And I think you all would have seen the most common one. I think Deepika Padukone was endorsing Oppo phones, right? So, you know, they show her holding the phone and like she's using the phone and things like that. And for that reason itself, many people will go and buy the phone. Okay. I think it's very stupid, but it's a very common thing for it to happen. You yourselves have a lot of celebrities. Or you'll have fans of celebrities. So when the celebrity that you really like ends up doing something, even you'll be like, oh, even I want this. Okay, I think very recently, even Nayanthara, I'm a huge fan of her. So I think she's absolutely beautiful. Okay, and when I found, I'm not a person who's a lot into, say, products and beauty and things like that. Like I don't think something like, okay, this influencer or this celebrity is using this product, so even I'm going to use this product. But when I found out that Nayanthara had started her own, beauty product brand, I was all like, oh, let's check it out. Let's see what it is. And I actually wanted to buy it, even though it was exorbitantly pricey. So that is the power of advertisement. So that's the power of an endorsement. So here the central authority can even come and say, stop this endorsement, stop this advertisement for a period of 1 year. And if they feel like there are subsequent contraventions, then this may extend from the 1 year period to the period of 3 years. Okay. So what exactly do you mean by a misleading advertisement? Misleading advertisement means you're falsely describing a product. Like very recently, actually, I saw one advertisement where it said, you can get an iPhone 15 for 33,000 rupees. Okay, and my first thing was, this is a false advertisement. But turns out, in a way, it could be true. Why is it? Because even though the phone is priced at around, I think, 70 or 80,000 rupees, I'm not sure of what it is. If you do certain discounts, or if you use a certain card or a credit card, or exchange your product in return, etc., you can get a maximum discount which can come up to 33,000 rupees. But how did they advertise it? They advertised it in one huge thing that said iPhone 15 just at 33,000 rupees. So what am I going to think? I'm going to be like, oh, iPhone 15, it's one of the latest. I can get it for just 33,000. So technically, the example I gave you is not exactly a misleading advertisement, or it can become a misleading advertisement if I take it up to the authorities. But in a way, it is misleading. It is kind of telling you that, making you believe and coming to the extent of buying it. Then when you've decided to buy it, you won't exactly back out, right? I mean, technically, if you look at it that way. So that's why falsely describing a product is misleading advertisement. Giving false guarantees, conveying an expression or implied representation that a certain manufacturer or seller has only provided that representation is actually an unfair trade practice, and then deliberately concealing important information. Now for point number three, if you look over here, let's say I bought a fridge, okay, and the person that I'm buying this fridge from is not LG. I've not gone to the LG showroom, but I've gone to some agency who's dealing with LG, with Samsung, with IFB, like whatever other brands there are. And so I feel like, okay, he seems to be an authentic person, okay? So this person is conveying, madam, if you buy this fridge, then you get a 3-year warranty or a 5-year warranty, okay? And believing that I'm like, oh, for 5 years, they'll help me take care of my product, and therefore I buy it. So what they're saying is, conveys an express or implied representation, which, if made by the manufacturer or seller, would constitute an unfair trade practice. So essentially, it's like saying it's not from the company itself, but if the company themselves did it, it would have been an unfair trade practice. And therefore, that itself amounts to some sort of a misleading advertisement. It's very simple, this concept. If the seller himself did this, it would be a wrong thing to do. And so if someone else ends up selling that seller's product, then it is equally wrong, no matter who does it. That's exactly what point number three is saying. And then there is one exception clause over here to the endorsers. That is all your celebrities and all your influencers. These people are not liable to penalty if they actually did a lot of due diligence to verify the claims made in the advertisement. Like I know some Tamil celebrities, they actually rejected a lot of very, you know, popular advertisement, I mean brands, simply because they were not okay with what that product represented, and so they actually rejected it. And I think today that's changing a lot. That's, you know, where celebrities itself are standing up and saying, okay, you know what, this product is not good, and if I endorse this, then I'm going to be doing more harm to people. And they're taking more proper steps towards endorsing the right products. And recently I found out in Singapore, they actually have an excellent practice. Now, I've only heard about this, I can't like exactly verify it, but each company or each service provider or product provider has to grade themselves in a certain A, B, C, and D. Now, they're graded based on the kind of food products that they're selling. And if their food products contain a certain amount of, you know, say sugars or certain other elements which are not exactly very healthy to the people, then accordingly they have to grade themselves. So if you're A category, then I think the amount of sugar in your drinks is under a 5%, whereas B is like under a 10%, whereas if you're a D, you're probably above like 20%. And I think it was Starbucks or something like that, who had a 56% sugar level in all of their coffees and their drinks. And Singapore's made it very clear, you have to inform the people that you have this kind of categorization. You can't hide that D category behind the board or make it in such a way where you can't see it at all. It doesn't work like that. You have to make it known to the people, knowing that only they will come in, they will buy products from you. And I think that's an excellent way to ensure consumer protection, because here people, when they're informed about certain things, they will change their products. And this will force companies also to do better in terms of what kind of product they're giving out to the people. So anyways, coming back, no endorser will be liable if they have done a proper due diligence. Okay? And next one, they're saying no person shall be liable to penalty if he proves that he arranged for the publication of such advertisement in the ordinary course of business, which means that the newspaper guy cannot be held liable for some false advertisement, right? His business is the activity of printing news. And so if someone comes and gives him a news saying that publish this in your newspaper, then he's just going to look at it and say, okay, fine, collect the money and go about it. Should he be punished for it? It doesn't make sense. Okay, but he should be aware of all the existing laws. Like, you cannot go around advertising drugs or something, right? So provided that he's he knows that okay, this is probably valid under law, then he can go ahead and publish it and he won't be punished. But knowing that it is violating an existing law, if he still publishes that advertisement, then they'll catch him also. Okay, while determining penalty, how to determine whether to give 10 lakhs penalty or just 1 lakh penalty? They'll simply look at it this way. How many people has that product affected? Then, how many times have you violated the consumer rights? The vulnerability of the people who were affected by your product. Were they people who could have absolutely not known about your product, or were they people who had knowledge? Like these are all factors which influence how much penalty needs to be given. And how much did you profit out of the product that you sold to these people? Well, keeping all of this in mind, that means if you affected the whole of India, you probably will get a maximum penalty. Or if you made a lot of money by selling a hazardous goods to people, you are definitely going to get a full penalty. Okay, but if it was a small violation, or the number of people affected were under 10 people, or a very, very small population, then it's likely that your penalty will be much lesser. Any authority, when always hearing you, they have to give you an opportunity of being heard. This is part of your principles of natural justice, and this will stand good. Okay. And next one is, first we saw what is misleading advertisement. The definition is given over here. What do you mean by endorsement? Endorsement is nothing other than a message, a verbal statement, or a demonstration. Okay, so it's just like Deepika Padukone taking out an Oppo phone and just holding it like that, and you know, it's just like she looks beautiful, but yeah, and just like really nicely holding the phone like that and looking, that itself is a message saying I'm endorsing Oppo. Okay, depiction of a name, signature, likeness, or personal characteristics of an individual. Like you'll see Virat Kohli suddenly walking in with Nike shoes. So people will be like, oh, so he's being endorsed by Nike. Okay, that is an endorsement. Or depicting any name or seal of an organization which the consumer actually believes is the opinion of that celebrity. Okay, so again, you'll see a lot of these famous cooks. If they suddenly take out a Shakti masala, okay, and they show it out, then you'll be like, oh, that person is probably using Shakti masala in his food, and his food tastes amazing, so even I'll buy Shakti masala. Okay, so endorsement means it is an advertisement, but it is the action of a message or simply showing a brand name. That's all. Okay. Over the multiple chapters that we've studied so far, I've told you time and again the provisions with regards to search and seizure. Okay, search and seizure is a very, very powerful thing given to certain authorities. Now, we may be looking at it in some, okay, search and seizure, if there's some product, you know, which is harming consumers, then search the premises and seize the products. But this is a power that is given to the Director General, means it's a very, very important power, because he has the power to enter any of your premises, do a search, do an investigation, and then if he has reasons to believe that consumer rights are being violated, he can actually enter into these premises, seize all the items, or he can lock it up. And he can say that till the investigation is over, I'm not going to release your products. Or he can seize the whole thing and never give it back. Okay. So this is a power. And like I've said, a power at any time is bound to be either abused or it can be used properly. If it is used properly, we have no problem at all. But if it is abused, there's going to be quite a bit of an issue. Okay, so that's why we have rules with regards to search and seizure. So as per section number 22, they're saying that if the Director General, after conducting an investigation, he has reason to believe that there is a person or people who are violating consumer rights or committing unfair trade practices or misleading advertisements, then this Director General can enter into the premises at any time and seize all the products, articles, documents, evidences, etc. Then he can make a complete inventory of everything that he seized, and he can even require the people in that warehouse to produce any kind of documents that he cannot find. Okay. Generally, with regards to search and seizure, there must be a proper procedure which is followed. if you don't lay out the proper procedure, then there's a higher chance that this power can be abused. And our CRPC 1973 has a very detailed procedure as to how to go about search and seizure. And because the CRPC has such a detailed procedure, they're saying that, okay, follow the CRPC itself for all matters relating to search and seizure. Now guys, I know there is some confusion with regards to, ma'am, our CRPC doesn't exist anymore, we have new laws in place. From an exam point of view, I don't think that those laws will be applicable for your current examinations. As and when ICSI notifies saying that these laws will be applicable to your examinations, then you can go ahead and write those specific laws. But for the time being, stick to whatever is there in your textbook. ICSI will release any kind of a notification stating that all students are required to refer to these laws while writing answers. In that case, we have to make reference to the new laws that are given. But until then, let's follow the same laws that's given as per your textbook. Okay. Now, since we're talking about procedure, we're coming to one main thing that the authorities have to follow. After seizing all of the items, etc., they have to return it within a period of 120 days. Okay. In this 120 days, they can take copies, they can take extracts, they can take samples, or there's a certain procedure for it. But within 120 days, it should be given back. But what if these products, what if these things that were seized are subject to natural and speedy decay? That means like it can be tomatoes or it can be fruits, and they probably have like some syrup or something like that injected into these fruits. So these fruits will decay very soon. You can't wait for 120 days, right? So in that case, they are allowing the Director General and or any of the other authorities to dispose of it. Means what? If it is a bunch of fruits, they will put it up for an auction sale. Okay, immediately how best to use that product, they'll put it off for an auction sale, or they'll just dispose of it because it's hazardous. It's going to cause harm to the consumers. Okay, so if not an auction sale, if it's something which is going to cause harm, instead of an auction sale, they'll just completely dispose it. Like I know at some point that they realized that drugs were being mixed in the food. Okay, how do you go around selling it to people? So what they did was they chucked the whole thing, like I think they burnt the drugs or they burnt those food items itself, I'm not sure what. This is how you dispose of it. And then obviously if it's subject to natural decay, you can't return it back within 120 days. Okay. Next part is saying if you can't determine if a good is defected or not, unless you're able to take a sample from the complainant, then they're saying that, okay, fine, take that sample, seal it up nicely, write where you took it from, the date, the name of the confiscating officer, all of it, and send it to the lab for a test. Okay, the lab will conduct a test of it. They will do all the reasonable chemical tests and they'll provide a report. And this report should be given to the district commission within a 45 day period. Okay, so guys, when we're talking about search and seizure, it's quite a big topic. We're talking about the powers of search and seizure, that is these three powers. Then after that, what is the time limit within which it should be returned? 120 days. If it is subject to natural decay, and if a good cannot be known unless it is tested, then how to go about it? You send it to the lab for analysis and test. And that report should be given to the district commission within a period of 45 days. Okay. Now, something known as a vexatious search, they're saying that the director general or any other officer who knows that there are no reasonable grounds for doing so and yet continues to do a search or cause a search or seizes any kind of articles, records, etc., shall be punishable with the imprisonment of up to 1 year or fine, which may extend up to 10,000 rupees or both. So vexatious means they are probably abusing their power. That means with absolutely no reason, they're coming in stealing, I mean, not stealing, seizing all of your goods and articles. This is known as a vexatious search, and the Director General will be punished for it. Okay. I'm going to stop over here. We'll start with the next topic, that is the District Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission, from the next class onwards.